This conference will now be recorded.
So in last session, we are able to generate the APIS classes from my partner Wistel. If you say that my classes, what I generated are here, like partners.espos.com. Let me open this class and see what this class exactly and how this class going to help me. Okay, so now let me click OK. And I'm just opening up that class what we generated right now. So this is my partners.espos.com. Okay, now let me close it and get it again. Let me open my developer console. So let's go to my open. I want to open my partners.espos.com. Okay, so when I open this class, see, this class also generated by WSDL to Apex automatically from the WSDL. So there are different classes. So you have seen there are many things. So now if you go in down, so to get the session information, what we can do, there is some kind of method. See, there is how to log out from the or how to log in, everything defined here. Okay, so how to invalidate session, all these things, all this configuration are defined here. If there is some session ID is there, if I want to invalidate, I can call this method. Same way, if you see, there is one method, should be like login. See, if you want to create any record, any subject record, you can pass it. If you see, there are many line of codes, around 5,000 lines of code we have for this new world. So if you go here, you can see everything. If you want to change one password, like many more things are there. So but I'm going to make it to focus in a particular place where I'll call, there is something called login, because I want to get session. So we'll see what kind of login are there. Okay, see, something login response element, login request element. Same way, I'll have some method which I'll call as login. Let me go to that login method. If you see here, there is one class called SOAP. Okay, inside this SOAP class, if I go, there is one method we'll get. Let me go to the method. Let me minimize all the methods what we don't want. I'll right now see, there are many functionalities we can do to find duplicate records. Depending on your configuration, what we have, we get many methods. But now we want to log in to the server to get the session, and in the second call, I'll pass the session ID to do my API call. To do that, I'll have one method which I call login method. Let me go to each methods and let's find out what is my method. You can see this is a method called login. I can pass straight username and password here, and I can do login. Okay, so simply I can do login. I'll also explain the mechanism where I will not pass the username password for my integration. This is my basic integration I'm going to show you in SOAP, where I'm passing my username password to login. And as a login result, I'll get my response. Okay, so what is this login result? If you see, login result is a class. Let me go there. Login result is a class where I have a session ID field. And this session ID, I can use it. So that's my complete idea behind it to use. So how am I going to use these things? We'll see it. Okay. So now what I do? So that means, I want to make a call to my login method. And login method inside where I have a class called SOAP class. If you see, there is a class called SOAP. In the SOAP class, I have a method. See, if you see here, this is my SOAP class. In the SOAP class, I have a method called login. If you see here, this login method, I want to call this. So how we can call? And this SOAP class is an inner class. This SOAP class is an inner class of which class? My class name is this. So as I want to call my login method, that means I have to instantiate my SOAP method, sorry, my SOAP class. So to do that, what I do, I'll go to my anonymous window. Okay, let me, first thing what I'm going to do here, first I'm going to invoke my partner whistle class login method. Okay, and my login method is inside where I have a soap class. My soap class is with my partner soap airsource.com class. So I have to instantiate this class, then I can call my login method. And my login method, if you see, in my login method, I am going to pass username and password. You see here my login method. Let me show you. It's quite easy, okay? Nothing to worry. So once you see these classes, you'll understand completely. We have to pass my username and password. So how I am going to do it first thing, okay? So that means I am going to instantiate my partner airsource.com dot soap class. Let's say I give my soap obj equal to, let me maximize it so that you will understand what I am writing. I am going to instantiate this class. Absolutely fine. Okay, so now in this class, what I want, we'll see step by step what kind of error I'm getting. I'm going to call my login method. So now I'm writing my username password here. So simply I'm writing my username. What is the username? And my server with whom I want to integrate, they shared my username and password with which I can connect to them. So let's see the username what we have. Devasish @server.com. Okay, and let's say password. As I know right now, I kept password as @1234. Simply, okay. So now to this login, I simply pass username and password. Okay. So now when I do, what will happen? If you see my login method, when you call to this login method, it's returning my response as a login result. See, this is my, I can say my login result. Okay, so login result, if you see this login result class having a session ID as a field, we'll see what kind of information I'm getting on this login result. Simply I'm going to print it for now to understand how I am going to get my login result record. There is more thing we have to do, so that I'll show you once I execute. Again, if you see this login method, I'm going to call to where? Let's if you see, whenever I'm going to call this login, I'm going to invoke to this endpoint. So this endpoint is a remote URL for me where I want to access, so it's not authorized. If I want to call, what will happen? It will give me again unauthorized endpoint. I can take this endpoint and I can add in my remote site setting. Simply I can go here in my setup, I can go to remote site setting and I can add my remote site setting. So as a straight line or as a summary, you keep a note, whenever you want to connect to anywhere outside of Salesforce through SOAP or REST, you have to add your remote site setting. Let's, I can say partners. Okay, let's partner login. I give some name, I make active. Done this much now. Now let me invoke again. What is happening? Okay, so it's happened, but you see there is some error I got. Web service callout failed. Login must use security token. So invalid username, password, or security token. So my call is going to appropriate place, but there is no security token. So now if you see in the server, let me show you my server. Okay, where my server is? Okay, here my server. If I go to user list, I try to call to this server to connect, correct? So now if I see the users, to the user which I try to log in, what is happening there? If I go to my user list, let me open it. So I was just trying to call this devices at server.com. If I open it here, we can see the login history. What is happening? If you see the login history, it's saying API security token required. So it's not allowing us to log in because we need the security token. Okay, so that means with this call, as IP ranges are not open, okay, as it's have a restricted IP range, so simply we have to put security token here. There are two options. What you can do, you can in the server, okay, you can define all the IP ranges for your profile, or based on the permission, you can set IP ranges for all. I'm not going to define the IP ranges now. I want to put security token to show you. If you don't want to put security token, or if you're not having any issue with the security tokens, if all IP ranges are open up, then you no need to have security token. So if you don't want to use security token, simply you can open for all IP ranges like this. You can define all the IP ranges. So I'm not defining it. If I save, it will allow me to go. I'll show you in the both the parts. So okay, I just set my IP range for all for this profile, and now if I try to call, let me go to here. Okay, if I try to call now, see, it will be successfully logged in. Okay, if you see my login history in my server account, if you see the login history, I am able to log in successfully, which returning me in the session also. If you see my login history, see, successfully I logged in as other Apex API, but I don't want to use my IP range. I'm simply deleting it. Okay, I want to show the both the ways how you can do it. Okay, so now if once you able to successfully log in, you can see the responses I'm getting here. Completely whatever I want, I'm going to get here. Okay, so now what I do, as I removed my login IP range, and if I try to invoke once again, I'll get same error, invalid security token. If you get this error, what you can do in the production, sorry, in the server, okay, go to my setting. Okay, if you go to my setting, here you go to my setting. Okay, both options, you can go from classic or here, wherever you want, you can go. Then you can see reset my security token here. You click this reset my security token, then you will get a security token on your email, and that security token you can use. Let me open my Gmail where I should receive a security token. See, I got a security token here. So this is my security token. So you can read the email. We have sent you security token because of this request. Okay, we can use security token in API, desktop and client, what you want. I can copy this security token. I can share with my client. Then client, when want to make a call, what they can do? With the password, they can suffix my security token. So if your IP range are not enabled, then you can share security token with your password. Your password plus your security token. Then you can click on execute. Now with this, what happened? I'm able to log in successfully to my server where I'm going to get my responses. So if you see the history in the server side, let me see the history in server side. You can see login history successfully. So now that means I have my session information. So now I can make a call to pass my web service SOAP call. So if you see, my login is successfully happening here, correct? So now we'll see how am I going to make a successful call to my web service. Quite easy. So as I was explaining, if you see my class, SOAP Lead Manager class, I have to create object of this as my web service calls first, SOAP Lead Manager. Then inside this, I have a class called SOAP. Let me show you. Sorry, I have a class called Lead Manager. Let's say I can say lead service equal to new object. I'm just instantiating it, which I have shown you in the previous session. Okay, now what I can do with this lead service, yeah, before I usually call to my new method create new lead. Let me show you that. If you go to my lead manager, there is a method called create new lead. I was calling this. Okay. So with this, what I'm going to do now? Same way, create new lead, and I'm going to pass some information. So let's see, name as Devasis, last name as Jenna, and then my company name as CTRLF, and then my email as devasis@gmail.com. Then I'm going to set my phone. Let's consider my phone I gave +971 562 83 6602. Okay, I used to call this, but when this call happens, if I try to execute again, I will get my invalid session ID error once again, because with my subsequent call, I didn't define what is my session on this call. How I'll define session? If you see on this class, there is one attribute. Let me show you. There is an attribute called my session header. The session information I have to pass as a session header. So before to that, what I do? I have to build my session header object to pass session ID. How I'll do? I have to create, or I have to instantiate this object. Okay, see, my session header element, let's see, I say yes session obj equal to new this class. I hope you are not confused yet. I'm just trying to make it step by step. Okay, so I have to pass this session header. To pass this session header, what I do? I have to set some value here. To set some value, I need to set what is the session header element. So if you see, session header element is a class which I instantiate now. Let me go and find out here. And here I have, in session header element, I have a variable called session ID. So this session ID I have to set. If you see, I am creating an object for this class session header element, and then in that class I have a variable I want to set it. What I do? My object name dot session ID I have to set. So where I will set, where I have session ID? If you remember, in the login result class, I have a session ID. If I open my partner swap expert.com, I got my login result. If you remember, if I go to my login result class, there is a session ID. So from login, when you logged in, what is the result came? In there, I have a session ID, I have sandbox, server URL, user ID, everything. From there, I want to take the session ID. I set in my current SOAP lead manager class session header element session ID. So this session object I can pass in my subsequent call. Now I have session information. I am setting my session information. I am going to send. How I am going to set my session information? If you see my login method. Okay, let me show you my login method. There are many things we are doing one by one. Let me go to this lead manager. In the lead manager class, if you see, there is one object called session header, one property or one variable called session header of type session header element. I have to set this. Simply, I can set under my lead manager object, nothing but my lead service dot session header. What I have here, session header element. This field, what I have, I can set session header equal to what I want, this session obj. Simply I call this. So now if I break this in three part, I use my partner whistle to get my login result. Then in the step two, what I did, I use my session header object where I have to set my session ID. Then in my step three, I am going to pass session object with my SOAP call to access my web service. Now, if simply I will go and invoke it, what will happen? I go click on execute. So successfully, I'm going to build something. Now, if you see, I will get some response. If you see my log, I will have the responses, everything. I didn't track my response. Now, if I go to my server, if I go to my lead, let's see, is there any lead created recently? Yes, you can see there is a lead created with name Devashish Raina, what I passed from my API call, company CTRLF, and a phone number and email, what we passed here. Okay, you can see company CTRLF, Devashish Raina, whatever I pass, based on that, my record will create here simply. Okay, so now how these things are going to happen? Okay, how these integrations established successfully here? So there is only these three factors we have to take. So now we understood we have to set my session informations. To set the session informations, simply we use my partner SOAP S1.com class, where I invoke my login method, which return my login result as a response. Then from login result, I have taken my session ID and kept as a session header element object. Then that session header element object I connected in my web service call with calling my actual data. Okay, so the request parameter building nothing but in this case I set as my parameters here. Okay, and once you get the responses, we may get string responses, anything, we can access it and we can manipulate here. You can simply set whatever you want. Okay, next we'll see what more other things we are going to do with this SOAP API call, what other mechanism we can authenticate, and how we are going to invoke it. Stay tuned. I hope you are enjoying the session, and we'll have many more real-time scenarios to integrate, which we will see in the upcoming sessions. Thank you.